conference call is from a federal prison.
It's hard for me to sit here and justify in my head 7 life sentences because someone said I was a drug dealer. All of the money and the drugs that they had in the courtroom, none of that belonged to me. They had no tapes, not even a fingerprint of mine. They had nothing. And they made that into where they could take millions of legal money from me. Money that I acquired from representing Mike Tyson, the game, Wyclef, from doing movies. For 20 years I've been in the music business. For y'all to come take my property, to take my money, to take everything that I've worked for, to take my life, is ridiculous. And I am in shock that the justice system even works that way. I believe I went into that courtroom in front of the prosecutors who are already guilty. It wasn't about the fact-finding of the truth. This was about convicting Jimi Hendrix.
Search James Rosemond on the internet, and this is what you'll find.
James Rosemond,
better known as Jimi Hendrix.
Also known as Jimi Hendrix.
Jimi Hendrix has been accused for cocaine distribution.
An alleged drug kingpin.
Drug kingpin.
Drug lord.
Is now in the hands of federal authorities tonight.
He was pushing dope from California all the way to New York.
He turned himself into authorities in May for drug charges.
Using the mogul of distributing multiple kilos of cocaine.
This dude was moving thousands of kilos.
Popular opinion is that Rosemond is a ruthless criminal who infiltrated the music industry. A gangster capable of anything. Violence, intimidation, and even murder. An impression cemented when he was publicly accused of masterminding the infamous Quad Studio shooting of Tupac Shakur.
Rap star Tupac Shakur and 3 members of his group were robbed and shot.
Masterminded by Czar Entertainment co-founder Jimmy Rosemond.
Henchmen set the whole thing up, paying the trigger man $2,500 to do the job.
The 23-year-old was shot 5 times inside the lobby of a Times Square recording studio.
Police say controversial rap star Tupac Shakur was entering the street-level lobby of an 8th-floor recording studio near New York's Times Square after midnight when 3 robbers confronted him and his friends.
Although the event was extensively covered by many major media outlets, there have always been contradictory versions of what really happened that fateful night.
They ordered him to the floor. Tupac resisted. He was shot numerous times.
Twice in the head and twice in the groin area.
At least twice in the head, once in the left arm, once in the thigh, once in the groin area.
Shortly after the incident, hip-hop legend Fab Five Freddy interviewed many of the key players on their recollections of that night.
I had met Tupac when I was kicking it to him. We was working on the Little Sean album. I asked him what he'd like to be on a cut with Little Sean. He expressed that he wanted to do the cut. Andre Rell thought it was a good idea. I got back with Tupac and told him, yo, I'ma set up some time and we can get it going. So I got it together. This was the night of the incident.
These interviews told a completely different story than the growing narrative and were intended to be part of a Vibe magazine story.
It was a very popular place to record on that particular night. Different people apparently were in different rooms working on their different music projects.
The interviews never saw the light of day. Until now.
It went like this, you know what I'm saying? I had a fest with the Trillion Mafia.
On the night of November 29th, Quad Studios in Midtown Manhattan was a full house. The studio was a hangout for New York's most notable talent, Sean Puffy Combs, Biggie, Mobb Deep, Lil Cease, and the Junior Mafia were all working. Jimmy Rosemond and Andre Harrell were recording a track with Lil Sean for his next album.
We was waiting on Tupac. 10 o'clock rolled around, 11 o'clock rolled around.
Jimmy was paying Tupac to come in and lay down a verse on the track, a session he personally set up at the request of the record label.
Andre Harrell started getting a little anxious. asked me, am I sure that Tupac is coming? I commenced to pay Tupac. He asked me, I said, yo, money, where you at? You got niggas ready to lay down vocals.
Tupac arrived 2 hours late for his session. Biggie recalls his arrival.
No season, you know, when all of them was on a little turf, they got out there, they smoking weed, so they're looking down, they saw Stretch and Pac and all them niggas pull up. So, you know what I'm saying? He's calling them niggas, we all family, you know what I'm saying? We all fuck with each other. So he's like, yo, we up here. So niggas greet each other from upstairs to downstairs, and I said, well, we coming in, shit. You know what I'm saying? We in the back chilling. Next thing you know, we hearing, yo, Tupac got shot.
With Tupac was longtime friend and fellow rapper, Randy Stretch Walker.
Get around the corner and shit. We see this nigga standing in front of the studio room with a army jacket on. There's somebody sitting inside the door where the elevators and shit is at, and he's looking at a newspaper or something. So boom, they buzz us in, and the kid that was standing in front of the studio, he comes in behind us. Some people get off the elevator and walk out. As soon as they walk out, Money with the army fatigue and this other and the kid that was sitting there, they spit on us like, yo, y'all know what this is. These niggas got the drop on us. So boom, Pop turns around and he act like he's going for his joint. And then the shot went off. After the shot, boom, that nigga Pop hit the floor. Next thing I know, we down on the ground. After the shot's gone, some niggas panic and break out. Them niggas stayed there and took niggas' jewels off. Call a Pop a bitch-ass nigga or whatever, you know, just kicking him and shit. That kid with the green jacket just started hitting that nigga in the head with the joint, telling that nigga to shut up. After they finished robbing, nigga, they just jetted.
The three assailants got away with jewelry, including about $40,000 worth of Shakur's gold chains and a ring.
After the two assailants fled the scene, Tupac made his way upstairs to the recording studios.
About 12 o'clock, Tupac comes off the elevator. He made so much of a scene that we all looked toward the elevator door. It looked like he was in a fight. And then I seen the blood in his head. He was pacing back and forth, talking about call the police. And he turned around and looked at me and said, yo, you're the only one who knew that I was coming. You must have set me up.
A point Jimmy refutes.
It was a little extraordinary that so much people were stopping by. But people would come by and be like, yo, who's working there? And people would say, well, Tupac and Sean. The word definitely got out that Tupac was on his way.
Tupac was always very vocal with his version of what happened that night.
Well, tell me what happened at the recording studios in Times Square.
I got shot 5 times. I walked in, some dudes walked in and shot me up.
But almost everyone else who was there tells a conflicting story. Specifically, they differ on who shot Tupac and how many times he was shot.
They got different accounts of what happened, and I'm the one with the bullet wounds.
Stretch never left Tupac's side.
Tupac got shot trying to go for his gun or whatever. He made a mistake on his own. He did something to his motherfucker, so you know what I'm saying? I'm gonna give him a chance to tell the world what he did to his motherfucker, so.
It's not important that other people know what happened to me. I just said it. Now that I said it, it's dead. You can believe me or not believe me. I did what I had to do.
Jimmy recalls talking to Stretch and another witness later that night.
And it was one particular individual who was there when everything went down. He came off the elevator into the robbery. He got caught in the mix with Tupac when the gunman had came into the building. He was like, yo, one shot fired. And it came out of Tupac's motherfucking gun. You know what I'm saying? And niggas had disarmed Tupac and had pistol whipped. I didn't really believe Money when he told me that. It wasn't until, you know, I had a conversation with Stretch that he told me that the wound was self-inflicted, and other people that Tupac was close with told me that the wound was self-inflicted.
Do you know who shot you? No. Is that a no or is that a maybe?
No.
No one will ever really know why Tupac embellished the story like he did.
Nobody seen shit. The fourth issue, when they came back with a reply, everybody knew what I did. They knew what I said. I was acting. Who gets shot 5 times and acts? Oh, I didn't get shot 5 times in their vision. I only got shot once because they found the bullet.
Tupac, he's amazing when it comes down to the press, man.
In November of 1993, Shakur and two other men were charged with sodomy and sex abuse, as well as weapons charges.
Rap star Tupac Shakur is in a hospital recovering from serious gunshot wounds as a New York jury deliberates his fate regarding sexual abuse charges.
I kind of felt maybe this was a strategy for him to parlay to get around the case, and maybe I should hold him accountable for trying that strategy.
In a bizarre twist of events, rap singer Tupac Shakur checked himself out of Bellevue Hospital late Wednesday night after the 23-year-old was shot five times early that same morning.
The motive behind the incident may also be lost. Many of the players have passed on, and no one has ever been prosecuted.
I believe that this was a robbery. Anybody who was going to walk into that building was going to be robbed.
I had a conversation with Stretch. He told me how Tupac was feeling that the whole thing was geared toward him because of some other Brooklyn cat that he said some things about in the newspaper.
Was it just a robbery gone bad? Or was this a form of street discipline?
All I do is make rap. All I do is rap and talk loud. My biggest crime is talking loud.
We may never know. But what is clear is that after the shooting, Tupac became more antagonistic, and his relationship with the East Coast rappers forever changed.
Study how Party of Bullshit was me before I met Biggie. You don't hear my style in this rap. Study how after I met Biggie, Ready to Die come out, his whole style changed. Study. Study why I would be mad.
I don't know what was going on in the nigga head, just confused more than anything, you know what I'm saying? You get shot and then you go to jail, something you ain't even do, that's a twist in the mind up.
If you're gonna act like you a gangster or a G or the king of New York, I'm expect that. And when you don't come through, then I'm gonna crush your empire.
You really wanna shit on a nigga, shit on the right nigga, don't shit on your man. That's my man, he always gonna be my man.
Half of the major New York rappers, or they managers, or they agents, or they somebody was there when I got shot. And nobody could give me no information.
They singled out Tupac during that whole thing. That nigga was stomping him, they was pistol whipping him, it was personal. And that's why Tupac felt it was a setup, because they didn't stomp on Stretch, they didn't stomp on Fred. They didn't do anything to anyone else except Tupac.
History remembers the Quad Studio shootings as the catalyst of the East Coast, West Coast rap war.
The rumors that's spreading is on some tip like we set them up.
Overthrow the government y'all got right now, which is Bad Boy and Nas and all that bullshit.
Straight up Brooklyn in the house! Come to Jeff Rock.
This call is from a federal prison.
Everybody in the industry, nobody came off the elevator saying that, yo, you set me up.
What started as rumors and allegations became urban legend when Tupac berated Jimmy in his song, Against All Odds.
Did I mention, promise to pay back Jimmy Henchman? In due time, I need you bitch niggas just listening. The world is mine, set me up, wet me up, niggas stuck me up. Heard your guns bust, but you chicks never shut me up.
He mentions a whole bunch of people's names in that record. And if you knew Pac, you knew why. He mentioned street guys and the record is only because that was the kind of attention he wanted toward that record.
Regardless of Tupac's intention, the song became his epitaph, forever pointing blame at Jimmy.
You know, in his death, he turned into a whole other kind of animal. Tupac's assault ended up becoming what Kennedy's assassination was in Dallas.
The rumors and speculation of Jimmy's involvement persisted for years.
The crazy thing about that whole thing is me and this guy never had no problem. We've never had an argument outside of him feeling like, hey man, can you tell me how these guys knew that I was coming to the studio?
In 2005, Jimmy made an attempt to clear his name by allowing Ethan Brown to write an article on him.
Ethan was going to put it in the New Yorker. He had claimed he was writing for at the time. And we felt, okay, if we're going to do it for a big magazine like that, let's just get it out the way and hopefully the rumors can subside. I gave him full access to me behind the scenes doing what I do as a manager.
If Jimmy wanted redemption, the story had the opposite effect.
He starts the article off saying that I am the uber villain in the music industry.
Published in Vibe magazine, he was portrayed as the real bad boy of the music industry.
I just didn't know how the New York magazine article turned into a Vibe article. I could have done a Vibe article with a writer I felt was more compatible to me.
By 2008, Jimmy's reputation was already problematic.
If you talk to guys in the East Coast, my name would come up. If you talk to guys in the West Coast, it would be Suge's name that came up.
Everything came to a head when LA Times published a story definitively naming Jimmy as the mastermind behind the 1994 Quad Studio shooting.
That Vibe magazine was a curse. Not only did I get on law enforcement radar, that's when I got on Chuck Phillips' radar.
Written by Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Chuck Phillips, it claimed Jimmy set up Tupac.
I've been the victim of people writing things that aren't true.
A story that was later revealed to be fraudulent, sourced from a con man who forged FBI documents.
Last week, Phillips admitted that he'd been duped, that the story was based on false FBI documents forged by a known felon, James Sabatino.
Rumors are rumors. You know, you either believe them or you don't. But I think when you have a reputable newspaper like the Los Angeles Times, with a Pulitzer Prize winner like Chuck Phillips to validate a rumor, then it becomes real.
Did you or did you not have anything to do with him being robbed or shot at Quad Studios in 1994?
Absolutely. Never even knew about it. Never heard about it before, afterwards. Had nothing to do with it.
The LA Times later retracted the story and provided Rosemond with a financial settlement. But the damage was already done.
Even with a retraction, even with them saying it's a lie, they still want to believe. Here it is, I was managing the biggest artist in Los Angeles, which was Game at the time, and people were canceling meetings for me. So I pretty much felt like my career in the business was over. The Jimmy Henchman connotation became real to people. It wasn't only the Tupac fiction that I was accused of. It was also that I was racketeering in the business, that I was extorting in the business, and I was walking in people's offices and shaking them down. The stories are unbelievable out there, Mom. There's no way for me to hide any of those facts if they're true. If they're true, then they have to be somebody who could come forward and say, Jimmy grabbed me, pistol whipped me, made me give them a piece of my check. There is no one that can say that I even gave them a bad contract. I became the music business boogeyman.
Next time on Unjust Justice.
He was one of our urban legends in the community. He established our reputation for no nonsense. You either came at him straight or you would want to leave him alone.
It was the dream of many guys that had lives on the street to get in this entertainment business. And to see Jimmy achieve these things in a solid business way without any of that street thuggery nonsense. And then to have your past stalk you like that.
Jimmy definitely has a bad reputation from his past. His past supersedes him, unfortunately.
For people to just malign his character by things that clearly didn't happen, it's an utter tragedy.